Oh, I'm surprised. I thought that'd be number two.
It's number one, actually. I put it on the list twice.
Oh, God, John. You just got
the top three is all Eternals, and then I just left a few things off that I didn't even want to talk about. So
what is happening there, Reject Nation?
We are here today to give our ranking of the 2021 releases from the Marvel Cinematic Universe. The time has come. Venom Let There Be Carnage will not be included on this list. Let's get that out of the way. If it was, it'd probably be at the bottom.
That and the Morbius trailer together.
You guys got your answer. Okay. Here we are. We have nine. We're going to go between the movies and the shows today. I'm excited to do this. Answers came. There's only one slot where I was like a little bit, which one should go here? But for the most part, I feel pretty confident. And if you guys have been following our journey throughout 2021, you know how we pretty much feel in depth about each one of these already. So we're just going with our hearts on this one. I don't know what John's list is, and he doesn't know mine.
Not seen a thing.
So let's get into it, people. If you go ahead, leave a like, that'd be very much appreciated. Anywho, I'll kick it off. Number nine on the list today, I have Eternals.
Oh boy.
That's right. I just wanted to kick off with a trigger warning.
Oh wow.
I just wanted to hit you. I don't even really feel that. It's really like number four. No.
Look out.
No, Eternals to me is a movie that the more I thought about it, the less I liked it. The more I deep dove with people about it, the more I just kept finding holes in it that I just can't. I get a little bit, I just check out when I watch it. I've tried a third time and I was like, yeah, this movie just ain't for me. I like ideas. Who doesn't like good ideas? But in terms of the way it was executed, just does not click for me, and I'm sorry to report that.
It's
but I'm
okay.
Also not sorry, because it's just my freaking opinion. Deal with it.
I accept your apology, Greg.
That's okay, John. What's number nine on your list?
Number nine on my list would have to be Black Widow. And doing this list, like doing the Spider-Man list, it was sort of a thing of like, hey, we've been so lucky. Most all of these have been enjoyable to some extent. And Black Widow is a movie that I did enjoy a good amount of, but a lot of it didn't quite hit the sort of emotional resonance that, you know, her send-off movie, I think, ought to. I mean, Scarlett Johansson. His performance is great. It gave us Florence Pugh as Yelena Belova for sure. I love the family dynamic the movie presents, but it does kind of devolve into a big sky battle, and there are a lot of things that felt like they could have been way more impactful in a TV series or something that could have been better expanded upon.
Fair enough. Number eight for me is Black Widow.
Hey.
For all the reasons you said, and funny enough, I'm pretty sure I liked it less than you.
Yeah.
Yet it fell at number eight because of everything you said, but the reason why it edges out Eternals for me is because I love the shit out of Florence Pugh in that movie.
Uh-huh.
It's fascinating to watch a movie that as it keeps going, I'm progressively not liking it and finding myself more disappointed than I am like, screw this movie. But it did something amazing to me, which was somehow I fell in love with Yelena, and every time she was on screen, I was enjoying the movie. So because of that one ace in the hole, It edges out Eternals for me. Do I think Eternals has grander ideas, more ambitions? Does it do things that are more experimental? Absolutely. Is Black Widow more generic run-of-the-mill Marvel movie? Yeah, for sure. But Yelena Belova is something very special to me, and because of that, I'm like, that's the main reason I'd recommend that movie, and I'm encapsulated by her. So yeah, what's your number eight, John?
My number eight would have to be Marvel's What If. I was really excited for this show going in, and I enjoyed it throughout, but this was a very hit-or-miss experience, and some of the misses were concepts that I thought were particularly fruitful or could have been particularly fruitful. Marvel Zombies comes to mind. That was one I was so psyched for and ultimately left kind of disappointed by. There are stories like the Doctor Strange and the T'Challa Star-Lord that are really, really great and some of the top of the year in terms of just isolated episodes for me, but as a whole experience and being so excited for that broadening of the multiverse, it was fun, but it didn't ultimately feel that consequential. But I'm looking forward to season two still.
Well, it was almost number, what number are we on?
You will be number seven.
My notepad wouldn't let me do
them out of order,
bottom to top. I'm like, wait a minute, what number is my number seven? Would I was almost What If, but I'm actually gonna have to go with Hawkeye.
Okay.
Hawkeye to me was such a weird journey. The first two episodes was like, that was okay.
This is all right.
Just because it's street level doesn't make it on par with the Netflix shows. Don't get why people keep saying that.
Yes, agreed.
Then the third episode happened and I was like, whoa, what an episode. That was amazing. That was fantastic. I really enjoyed 4 and I really enjoyed 5. I think those three were great, but the finale episode ultimately left me very disappointed on so many levels that the more I talked about it, the more I started being just more disappointed with the way they ultimately handled so many different storylines. I get they had a lot to juggle. Does that mean the execution sat well with me? Ultimately not. Here's the thing, is I liked Hawkeye. I did like it. But the fact of the matter is that by the time we got to those closing moments, it's like, I really enjoyed the middle of this show a lot, but the beginning and the end, not the biggest fan of, and just didn't quite click with me. So yeah, I ultimately went with Hawkeye.
Fair enough.
And Yelena's great and it steals the show whatever she's on.
Hi.
She adds so much credibility to each of her little appearances, whether it be movie or show, that you almost want to bump each one up just because of her.
Yeah, and I also think that Kate Bishop, Haley Steinfeld, is perfect casting, and I can't wait to see her in more Marvel properties for sure. And I'm looking forward to Echo. I am.
Likewise.
But as the show itself, yeah, ultimately let down by that finale.
Fair enough, G. My number 7, much to I'm sure your chagrin, is Eternals. You know, this was a movie that, yeah, I liked a fair amount more than you did, although I don't love it. It's one of those where I kind of came out in the middle of people where I was like, I didn't really share a lot of the immediate gripes of the experience of watching it. I appreciate the swing that it is. However, I can definitely admit that it doesn't fully grasp what it's reaching for. It doesn't feel quite as grand and consequential as one might have hoped. And while it does shine through its cast, there could have been better or richer material for them to really dive into. I feel like a lot of the philosophical discussions, while I appreciate them, are very, you know, surface level, because there's so much to do and so many characters to balance and so much to communicate in a small amount of time. And it's another example of something where I'm like, man, if this had been a series of some sort, this could have really reached its full potential. But as it stands, I appreciated it as a piece a bit more than I would be like, let's just throw on Eternals, you know?
Yeah.
So.
Oh, I'm surprised. I thought that'd be number 2.
It's number 1, actually. I put it on the list twice.
Oh, God, John. You just got
the top 3 is all Eternals, and then so is number 7. And then I just left a few things off that I didn't even want to talk about.
So much about Eternals. I was like, I'm just going to brush this off the list really fast.
Sure.
I'm not even going to go into it.
Yeah. You don't got to. We've done it. We've done too much talking about Eternals on this channel.
Hour with Koi, non-spoiler already. So,
yeah, let's hear his ranking.
Number 6. Number 6 for me would be Marvel's What If. Like what you said, very hit or miss for me, but I enjoyed it more often than not. Sometimes I just find myself thinking about that Doctor Strange episode, how mesmerizing it is. It's so beautiful, and to me, it's one of the best animated things Marvel has ever done. In terms of the animation I was privy to towards 2021, it was like the top. I'm so astounded by it. So like when you see what they're doing in Multiverse of Madness, a big part of what really factors into the excitement and anticipation for that is what they specifically did in What If. Were there some episodes that were just duds? Yeah, there definitely were. And the finale, while really like, oh my God, this is fun, did find a lot of criticisms as we started talking about it, but the immediate experience was a total blast. I do like all the doors that it opens up. Do I wish almost every episode was longer, and do I wish almost everyone did a little bit more? Yeah, I do. Did I feel like they kind of sacrificed a lot of what could have been gravitas and weight for kind of just passable kid-friendly entertainment? Sure. At the same time, though, what it does open up in the realms of possibilities, I think What If has set a good foundation, and that Doctor Strange episode that's just like, enough for me to tell people to go watch this show. Yeah. It's just, you just skip right ahead and watch, there's a T'Challa episode and watch that one and you're good to go.
Maybe that's the best of the best. Best of the best, yeah, for sure. All right, well, my number 6 then, moving upward, is Hawkeye. Uneven, but I really loved the stuff that worked. This was one I deliberated probably over the most because I think that there's some work in this show that is my favorite of the year, especially when it comes to Jeremy Renner's performance, his embodiment of the PTSD, the hearing loss and whatnot, his relationship to Kate Bishop, Haley Steinfeld. Terrific, like really terrific. I love the Christmas vibe, and a couple of those middle episodes really hit. And ultimately, while it's cool to get spoilers, people like Kingpin into the mix, there are things that just felt like they were blunted or done without as much thought and foresight. It kind of became distracting rather than a big exciting moment when it all ended up. But yeah, as a piece, it's kind of frustrating because a lot of it could be better, but what worked really worked, and it really did bring out the feeling of the season, and for that, I quite appreciated it. So could have been better, but I thought it was a solid entry for the things that really work about it.
Agree. I do.
Thank you.
I do, John.
I'm glad you won't be leaving this with like a bunch of gossip about how much of an idiot I am.
No. If anything, I have the more. I have the list that's maybe not as reflective of the majority. What's the next number?
Number five.
Five on the list for me would have to be Falcon and the Winter Soldier.
Hey.
Is that yours?
Me too.
Okay, there
Perfect.
We go. Falcon and the Winter Soldier, I feel like, is the one that has been one of the least impressionable ones throughout the year. And I feel like it's just because of the service of where it goes for the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Mm. It's like, yeah, Cap handed off the shield to him and Bucky was cool with it. And now it's just watching him go through the process of emotionally accepting it.
Yes.
Is the overall point. But really, I'm like, if they just did another movie and he was Captain America, I'm like, there's this whole middle chapter journey. It's kind of like what Star Wars does with, yeah, we already have the films, but now let's just fill in some blanks. And that's kind of what this feels like.
Yeah.
But I think it's a really well executed version of that. Like, are there essential pieces? Absolutely. Julia Louis-Dreyfus being introduced into the mix. What's her ordeal? They have U.S. agent John Walker in here. And I actually think that politically, all the themes they decided to explore, I was pretty surprised by how much Marvel didn't hold back with what they wanted to delve into. Sometimes it was a little bit more overt than subtle. Yeah. At the same time, I still thought it was very effective. I think the performances by both Sebastian Stan and Anthony Mackie, I thought, were very, very strong. Some plot lines don't hit as much like the Flag Smashers, but freaking Wyatt Russell, excellent in the show. The action was, you know, it was good. But overall, I think in terms of a complete story for that season, I thought they solidly executed it. I thought they did a wonderful job, and I was very much impressed with that. I feel like this would probably be lower on a lot of people's lists, but for me personally, I thought that it was quite moving.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think it was, and it hit some of my favorite attempts, at the very least, out of any Marvel property this year. The things it wanted to discuss, the things it did start to discuss, especially through characters like Isaiah Bradley and through characters like John Walker. Like, some of that stuff was the most striking and memorable of Marvel this year. And the show overall, I would say, it's a solid series.
Yeah.
It could have arisen above that, and it could have easily gone more wrong. You can feel that something with the Flag Smashers was excised or reworked. So it is held down by certain things. But yeah, I thought it was a really straight ahead and well conceived story and very well acted as well.
Well, see, what I think is so effective about it is, even though Steve Rogers is not in it, it's probably the most Captain America it could be, because it's all about what does the shield represent and what does it mean to be Captain America, and they explore through many different characters' experiences.
And who is America now?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. This is America.
Don't get you slipping.
All right. Four?
Number four.
Number four.
Yeah.
Let's see when we start lining up.
Yeah.
Number four for me would be Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings. Are you tied with me on this one, too?
I'm tied with you on this one, too.
All right. Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings brought my Chinese culture to life.
That's right.
My little bit
You always talk about your Chinese heritage.
My little bit of Chinese blood in me, my 2%. I'm like, finally, I'm represented on the screen here.
You wept. I was there.
No, this movie was just a total blast. I loved the first half of this a lot. I think the way they utilized culture was great. It's got some of the absolute best action out of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. This, to me, was a great, grand movie-going experience. Simu Liu, so damn charismatic. Wen Wu, Mandarin, easily became one of my favorite villains, if not my favorite, out of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. I know that often gets people going, really? More than Thanos? Yeah, I understand, but emotionally, I click a little bit more with what they did with him there. I think he just brings such pathos to the role. The thing, though, is like, while I think Falcon and the Winter Soldier actually is a better complete story, maybe perhaps better writing, actually, overall, because like Shang-Chi's last half especially is where the film starts to kind of lose me a little bit. While there's some great things to behold in there, I do have some problems with the way it is ultimately written in terms of dialogue and just overall execution. Still, though, like the visual experience and the emotional experience overall to behold was like, yes,
yes.
Cinema.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Like, you know, these lists are more emotional than they are logical. And I feel like, yeah, this one for me, for sure, number four.
Yeah, absolutely. It was dazzling in an action sense, in a cultural sense, in a storytelling for the MCU kind of sense. And yeah, while there are certain things that I think could have breathed more, for me, this was a good example of a movie that really makes the most out of the economics of time that it is constrained to, because it has to do a lot in a very little amount of time for what it's doing. And even though a lot of scenes are very short, I thought they were able, in the writing, to wring the utmost out of those. And I've seen, you know, worse examples of that across the year. And yeah, at the end it does start to sag a little bit under the weight of just effects and being this crazy cacophonous MCU battle, but hey, you even get kaiju in there, so yeah, this was very striking and one of the highlights of the year for sure.
And I also think the music is some of the most memorable.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Here's where I get really curious to see if we still line up. All right, my number three would have to be, oh my god, I'm actually in conflict with myself. Nah, I just gotta go emotional. While I think this should be number two in a lot of ways, I would say that my number three is actually Loki. I did deliberate back and forth a little bit of, is this number two? I'm only going with this as number three just because of the fact that, I don't know, because I am. Because of the emotional...
It's your list, damn it.
Just because it's my list. I love the hell out of this show. Tom Hiddleston absolutely kills it. The introduction of Mobius and Mobius, freaking brilliant. I like Sylvie a lot, and I love when they sit down and just have like philosophical, existential conversations. I like how it's sci-fi heady without getting too lost in its own ass. You know what I'm talking about. And at the same time, as much as I love the finale, sometimes when I think about it, I wish there was a better close for a season one. And not so much leaving me like, there's so much left untold. While I felt like Loki's arc was complete, and maybe that is just the point of it, I ultimately do feel that in terms of a story, I could have used a little bit more of a chapter close, but with teases of more of a cliffhanger of what's to come. Am I communicating that clearly?
Yes.
I hope so, because
closure.
I do love the show. I do. I love the hell out of it, and I was like, should this be number two? But it ultimately wasn't.
Well, lovely.
Yeah.
Because my number three is Spider-Man No Way Home.
Yeah.
I thought if we're purely talking emotion and no sort of tempering with, you know, like my film critic hat on, that might be close to number one, if not. But Spider-Man No Way Home, what hasn't been said, it's super dazzling. It gets the MCU Peter Parker finally on the right track with aplomb, with huge emotion, with huge resonance, with big action, with all this gratifying fan service that is handled in such a way that actually feels authentic and doesn't feel like they're just cannibalizing parts because they know that we love them. There is, I'll maintain, you know, a good amount of kind of slapdash detailing to get you to point B and C throughout this movie, but the stuff that works is some of my favorite of the year. It took me back. It made me feel like a kid. The array of characters on screen and the moments they were given just transported me to a whole other plane of feeling. So yeah, while I don't think it's a perfect film, it is one of the most memorable and beautiful experiences of the year from Marvel, and something I never thought I would see happen, and I'm never going to forget the experience of, you know, watching for the first, second, third time, all of that, you know.
Yeah. That's why it's my number two.
Hey, perfect segue.
A lot of people will probably be like, you know, if you watch Loki and then you watch Spider-Man No Way Home, both at home, you're probably going to realize Loki is a better written told story. Yeah, I get where you're coming from. Trust me, I do. Like, but here's the fact. That's not how I experienced Spider-Man No Way Home. I saw it three times in the theaters, and that's what's going to stick with me. It's the same way of how when I think about Return of the King, as many times as I've seen it at home, I think about that first time I saw it in the theaters every single time. And Spider-Man No Way Home is going to have that similar effect. Rarely is there a thing where someone points out a flaw with that film, especially in the first half, where I go, wrong. Okay, let me tell you why that's not a flaw. Most of the time I'm like, yeah, I can see. Still, the movie does such a good job at focusing on the emotional beats it wants to hit that a lot of the time that washes over some logical gaps in the storytelling for me.
For sure.
And I think that's really effective. I think that is so damn effective. And the last half is almost near perfect to me. I love the hell out of this movie. And it's crazy how a movie this hyped so delivered on so many things that it, maybe not everything, but the main things it needed to deliver on, I thought it for the most part delivered on.
Absolutely it does.
And it got me excited for Spider-Man 4 as opposed to feeling like, well, can't get better than that, you know?
Yeah. No, for sure. All right. This is the portion where I just continue setting you up for stuff, because my number two is WandaVision.
Wow. Your number one is, oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Look out.
Oh, wow.
Put on an Oculus, get your stereo speakers, Owen Wilson off. WandaVision is one of the most memorable and interesting things that Marvel's put out this year. And in formulating this list, I was like, wow, I have so many vivid memories and moments from this show, despite the fact that it came out in January of last year. The way that they were able to bend the style in such a perplexing but engrossing and beautiful way, the way they were able to tell this really anguished love story across, you know, these different characters, bring in a lot of Easter eggs and things that are fun to get people discussing and whatnot, but ultimately not losing sight of the story because of those things.
True.
I mean, you had your Ralph Boner or whatever, and for me, I mean, the only reason this really lands at number two is because the first two acts are so interesting and so in the world of the characters, and then once you get to the end, there's kind of a big powers battle, which I don't begrudge them, which I don't think is bad. This is still number two on my list. I think there's some really great stuff there as well. But, you know, the first two thirds especially had me so gripped. And I think you said this in a review. You were like, well, they're having the big power battle with, you know, Wanda and Agatha. I kind of want to be having the ship of Theseus talk. You know?
Yeah.
So, like, that's about the only gripe I would level at it. But, yeah, the sitcom stylings, the performances across the board, they really stuck with me. They really impacted me. And yeah, WandaVision, terrific show.
Yeah, man. Number one for me is WandaVision. It really, truly is. I mean, come on. What is grief if not love persevering? Do you remember the first time you heard that line? Holy shit, Vision.
Theme stated.
Why I would rank it number one. They managed to take characters that have been in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, who have always been like, yeah, they're all right. They're okay.
Yeah.
And I fell in love with them. Out of any of the shows or movies, in terms of character-driven narrative, they were the ones that I thought just skyrocketed to another level in terms of adoration. I fell in love with them as the couple of the MCU, and I was heartbroken for them by the end of that series. One thing that created a bit of a stain for that show is the over amount of hype with theories and stuff. I was fortunate enough to allow myself to watch the whole show twice, where I could really just take it in. And I loved how it, I think it's more experimental than anything else Marvel has done this year. Like, they start off with just like, let's riff on some sitcoms with some minor clues in here,
yes,
for people to latch on to. And then it just starts taking a turn into more sci-fi darkness and dread and then witchcraft. And while I think the finale, sure, it's definitely not perfect and it does become a lot of like laser beam, bam, bam, action stuff. At the same time, there's so much about that finale that I still do love so much. Like, all my criticisms are pretty much only stuff that occurs in the finale, but there's still so much beautiful things to behold about it. I do love how weird it is. And honestly, you know, in terms of experience shared with audiences, Spider-Man is Spider-Man. You're going to be hyped no matter what because it's freaking Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Whereas WandaVision, guys, you remember what it was like when it came out? No other Marvel show generated that level because people were like, some of my theories didn't come true.
Yeah.
but WandaVision was so much of what is going on,
yeah,
but I'm into it.
Yeah, you know? I have to know.
I don't get it, but I'm into it.
I gotta tune in next week.
Here are the clues. At the same time, it wasn't only about that. It was still about the rich experience of these two characters. And Agatha Harkness is awesome. You know, like,
Agatha all along.
Yeah.
Best jingle of the year.
For me, that, like, if we're going to talk about the passion it generated, the creativity, the audience experience backed with just watching it at home by myself experience. Yeah, that's WandaVision. Yeah, that was like an easy top one for me. I know it's not for a lot of people, but for me it is.
No, it's terrific. And then that only leaves my number one.
I think we both left clues.
We both did, yeah. Just instinctually, because that my number one of the year was Loki. I really was dazzled by and transported by Loki, and dealing with multiversal consequences and dealing with, you know, getting even more sci-fi about the MCU. I thought they did a great job with that, but also doing a great job deconstructing their central character, pitting him against different versions of himself, and really giving you this in-depth character arc over the course of the show while balancing that against all of these turning wheels and spinning parts The relationship with Mobius is one of my, is probably my favorite thing out of Marvel all year. Perhaps, you know, right on par with the Spider-Man altogether. But yeah, I was really enthralled by Loki, and I love what it, you know, portends to the rest of the universe. I'm maybe a little taken aback that a lot of the other stuff this year didn't really acknowledge or mention it, but I cannot wait to drop back into that world and continue dealing with the TVA and Kang and all that madness that's coming up. So yeah, I loved Loki quite a bit.
Well, there you have it, folks. Eternals is terrible.
That's the only takeaway you should have, is Eternals is terrible, Spider-Man No Way Home is the best movie of all time, and somewhere in the middle, everything else.
I'm just joking. I saw how much it riled people up when I had an opinion about that movie. Right, so it's just fun to me now.
Don't worry. You're on...
it came and went.
You're on the Matrix people's good side.
Yeah, guys. What is your ranking of the Marvel film? When you combine this all together, what is your ranking? Leave your thoughts down below. Subscribe, click that bell, hit that like button. Yo, guys, we'll catch you guys soon, but not before we do a Flev Doran. Choosing you, Flev, because you love it when we shout you out on something Marvel related. And it doesn't get more Marvel than this video right here, right now. Flev, you have been one of the greatest supporters of our Super Eject page for so long. Constantly showing your love in the comments and then occasionally giving a poke as to why we haven't done something yet. And I appreciate that about you, man.
Keep
You're
us on
like
task.
A manager for us. One day, Flev, you and I are going to meet up. We're going to have a coffee, and I'm not going to drink any coffee because
nope.
I hate coffee.
Yeah, he does.
Not a fan of
he
coffee.
He does not like coffee.
So I'll probably sit across from you, have some tea, and then probably have to urinate pretty quick because it's a diuretic. Then I'll use that opportunity to sneak out the window and then watch you from afar and see what's he like when I'm not at the table with him.
Why is he crying?
And then you're going to see me looking at you, and I'm going to duck away. Then I'm going to go back through that bathroom window, sit across from you and go, "Hey, Flev, I was just in the bathroom taking a shit the whole time.
Do you see anything strange while I was gone?"
Anyway, happy new year. Tell us what your plans are.